स्टूडेंट्स वेलकम बैक टुडे आई एम राधा फ्रॉम डीपीएस हल्द्वानी लामाचौर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट अनदर टॉपिक ऑफ द सेम चैप्टर दैट इज सेल द यूनिट ऑफ लाइफ सो अप टू हियर व्हाट वी हैव कवर्ड वी हैव डन दैट व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ सेल्स प्रोकैरियोटिक एज वेल एज यूकैरियोटिक सेल्स व्हाट आर द डिफरेंस बिटवीन दीज टू एंड We have done the characteristics of prokaryotic cells or the structure of the prokaryotic cells. Now, we are moving towards the structure of the eukaryotic cells. And out of them, we have covered some of the components, right? So, one by one, as we have said, that we will discuss each and every component of the eukaryotic cell, right? So, we have started with the first one, that is a cell membrane. What is cell membrane? We know that the membrane which is present in the cell, right? And in case of plant cells, there is one more layer outside this plasma membrane, that is what? Cell wall. While in case of animal cell, the cell wall is absent. So you can see directly the plasma membrane. And this plasma membrane, it is also known as cell membrane or the plasma lemma. That much we have done. Now we will study that the structure of the plasma membrane, how it looks like. Okay, if you will see the structure of the plasma membrane, as we have said in the study of the RBC. Okay, so why they have studied or they have observed the RBC only? Because RBC having no nucleus, okay, no organelles. Is present in case of RBC. So they have studied in the RBC and studied the structure of this plasma membrane, right? So in the previous one, the earlier one, they have gone through the several studies and found different models to understand about this plasma membrane. Okay, so in all the studies, general things, what they found that the plasma membrane is made up of what? It is made up of some of the lipid bilayer. If I will draw the lipid bilayer, what you will see that the lipid bilayer, they are having the outer membrane as well as the inner one, right? If you can assume like this, that if I will draw any of the structure, if I will draw any of the animal cells, okay, this is the animal cells. So what will happen? Directly there will be a plasma membrane, and this plasma membrane is made up of what? It is made up of this type of structure. Okay, you can assume like this. So this whole structure is what? This plasma membrane is lipid bilayer. It means that it is having two layers, the outwardly as well as the inwardly, right here. So you can see, what you can see, this type of structure for simpler form I have drawn here. So whole of this plasma membrane is made up of bilayer. It means two layer of lipids. That's why what we are saying, lipid bilayer, as well as they also contain some of the protein. Okay, it contains protein as well as the carbohydrate. So if I will ask the question that the composition of cell membrane is what? The lipids, okay, majority part, then protein, then carbohydrate. Along with this, you can see some of the cholesterol also, okay. I'm writing here cholesterol. This cholesterol is act as a lipid and it will present in the lipid bilayer, right? Now, first of all, as I have said, the major constituent of the plasma membrane is lipid. So, this lipid can be of two. Okay, it can exist in a two form. That's why it is also known as amphipathic. What you will call it? Amphipathic means that they are having two ends, polar ends as well as the non-polar ends. If I will talk about this polar end, it is hydrophilic. What it is? Hydrophilic means that philic means to move away from something, right? So if I will talk the tail, if I will talk about the tail of this head, what will happen? It is moving away from the water, okay, away from the environment. So this tail, which is present in this plasma membrane, what you will call it? You will call it, this is the non-polar one, or this is the hydrophilic. While this polar head, it is what? It is hydrophobic. It means that it is loving. So you can see that the inner part of this part, what you are seeing, this is a cytoplasm, right? and this is the external environment, right? If you will assume this is a animal cells, so what will happen? This is the outer environment, and inner to that there is a cytoplasm environment. So here also you can assume that the outer part is the outer environment, and this part will form like this. Okay, this will form the inner environment. So what will happen in both the cases, this tail acts as a hydrophobic, that's why it is away from this environment as well as the above environment, right? And as these are the hydrophobic, so these are present towards the environment in the upper part as well as in the cytoplasmic part, right? Here, so we have done that it is having two parts, hydrophobic as well as hydrophilic. If you will talk about the hydrophilic, as I have said, that it is outside of the membrane, okay, whether it from the outer environment or from the inner environment, it always and always protrude outwardly, right? And if you will talk about this hydrophobic, so what you will see that it is, how you can see that this hydrophobic, that it is away from it, means that they are not towards any environment. So what you can see, inwardly towards the plasma membrane, right here. And again, as I have said, that some cholesterol is also present in case of this plasma membrane. So if I will draw this structure like this, okay, some of the cholesterols are also there, okay. So these I have denoted with the cholesterol. So this cholesterol is very low amount, that is 25 to 32%, and where you can see it, you can see that some of the cholesterol is present in this, which one? In the hydrophobic form, okay. And these are some of the structure which is present here. So I'm rubbing it here, so you can see these structure here as well as here also, okay. So if you, I will talk about this cholesterol, it is present where? In this lipid membrane. And which one lipid membrane? Hydrophobic, right here. As well as you can see some of the phosphoglyceride and the phospholipid. What does it mean? As I have said, that it composed of lipid, okay, most part it is of lipid. So what will happen when the phosphate group will add with the glucose or the sugar molecule, we will say phosphoglyceride, or when it will add with the lipids, it will be the phospholipid. So as well as you can see some more structure in this plasma membrane, that is the phosphoglyceride as well as the phospholipid. If I will draw this diagram like this, so what you can see that some of the phosphoglyceride and phospholipid are also present in this plasma membrane, okay. And the percentage is given here. Now come to the protein. So we have said this part is lipid, okay. Along with this, some protein are also present. If I will draw this protein, okay, I'm drawing the protein also. So how can you say that this protein is present here in this membrane? So here two types of proteins can be there, that is the integral protein and the peripheral protein. Integral means that it is embedded inside, and peripheral means at the peripheral end. So how you will draw it? If you have to make the integral protein, it means that that protein structure is forming like this, okay. So what you can see that this protein structure is this one. It means that from outer to inside, it is wholly bound, or it is wholly embedded in the plasma membrane. So what type of protein it is? It is the intrinsic protein. What it is? Intrinsic protein. As well as you can see some of the protein here also, okay, some of the proteins bounded at the peripheral end. So what you will say? It is a extrinsic protein, right? So what is extrinsic? Which is present at the peripheral end, and intrinsic, which is integrated inside the plasma membrane or embedded inside the plasma membrane. It is known as the integral also, right? And this one is the peripheral. Now, if I have said that there are two types of protein, okay, in this plasma membrane, so what will be the role of this protein here? The role of this protein, that it will act as a carrier also. If some thing have to move from outer to inside the environment, okay, so this protein will act as a passage. This protein will act as a passage for the transportation of material from outside to inside, right? As well as Now we will understand that this extrinsic, the bond which is present in this extrinsic protein, okay, in this extrinsic protein, it will be very loose, while the bond in this intrinsic protein will be stronger one. So if we have to move, if you have to take something, it will be harder to break the bond of this intrinsic one, because bond is stronger one. If I have to take anything from the extrinsic one, it will be easier because the bonds are weaker, right here. So what we have said, two types of proteins are present in case of plasma membrane, intrinsic as well as the extrinsic protein. That much we have done. Now the third component, that is carbohydrate. As I have said, major component is lipid, which is a bilayer, then protein, which is embedded in the plasma membrane, right? Then the carbohydrate. Carbohydrate is one of the component which is present in this plasma membrane. So the diagram which I have drawn here like this, so these are what? These are some of the carbohydrate which are also present here, right? So you can see that carbohydrate is also there. And one important thing, when this carbohydrate is added with this phospholipid, okay, because I'm saying that carbohydrates present both in plasma membrane. So in plasma membrane, you have seen these are the lipids and these are the proteins. Okay, when it will bound with this lipid, what it will form? Glycolipid, right? When this carbohydrate will add with this peripheral protein, okay, these are the peripheral protein. So the things which is coming from here, what it is? It is the glycoprotein. Why? Because carbohydrate is added with the protein structure, which is the peripheral one, right? So we can say along with it, glycolipid as well as the glycoprotein is also present in the plasma membrane. So these are the components of the plasma membrane and how it looks like, right? Now one of the theory came here, that is the fluid mosaic model. Okay, so what is this fluid mosaic model? And question is that who gave this fluid mosaic model? So answer is Singer and Nicholson in 1972 gave the fluid mosaic model, and it is the somehow accepted one. Why? Because according to this theory, what they have said, that this membrane is made up of two layers of lipid, it is correct, as well as there are some integral protein. It means that the protein which are embedded inside it, these are known as the integral protein. That concept is clear here. We have done, right? Another one is that quasi-fluid nature of lipids. What does it mean? Quasi-fluid means not in a solid state, not in a liquid, somehow in a jelly form, right? So what will happen along with this one, okay, along this plasma membrane, what will happen? The nature of lipid will be somehow jelly-like structure, okay? And there will be some movement of protein. The protein which is present here, there will be some movement. Sometimes it can be the flip-flop movement, okay? What is the meaning of flip-flop movement? In which there will be change of the protein. If protein will change from here to here and it is moving towards it, so what you will call it? Flip-flop movement, as well as there will be some lateral movement of protein. Okay, it means that the protein which are present here, that peripheral protein, they will move in this membrane. Okay, how they are moving? They are moving in a definite layer. What you will call it? It is known as lateral movement of protein. Right here. So this lateral movement of protein, what it is? What it is showing? The fluidity of the lipid. Okay, so this question is important. It's the fluidity of lipid dependent on what? It is dependent on the lateral movement of the protein. If the movement will be more, we can say fluidity will be more here, right? So on this basis, one thing is given here, fluidity of membrane. It means that how the fluid will move in this membrane and how the transportation takes place here. Right, so on the basis of this, how it is moving here in this plasma membrane, there are two types of transport. What are they? Two types of transport, that is active transport and another one is a passive transport. Now what is this active transport and what is the passive transport? See here, that active means something which is in which we are getting or giving the energy, okay, in which we are giving any energy that one is the active one. Okay, and in passive transport we are not giving any energy, passively it is take place. So how it will take place? The first one, the inactive one, there will be transport or there will be movement of molecules. How it will take place? It will take place from the lower concentration to higher concentration. We know that according to the gravity, what happens that if anything move from higher to lower concentration, okay, if anybody is in the higher peak, okay, then as it will move towards the lower one, it doesn't require any energy. Okay, what it will happen? Passively it will move accordingly. How? For example, if any river is going, okay, if any river is flowing, what happens that if we are moving towards the floating, what will happen? It will not need any energy. But if we are moving upwardly, okay, when we are going upwardly, what will happen? There will be another force which will act upon it. Right, so same thing we can say, something will move from higher concentration to, for example, this is a higher concentration to lower concentration. What will happen? It will move passively, it will not require any energy. But when there will be just opposite, from lower to higher concentration, and we have to move from lower to higher concentration, what does it require? It required energy, as well as it will act as a against the concentration gradient. Okay, higher to lower is a towards the concentration gradient, and from lower to higher one, it is a against the concentration gradient. Right here, so we can say that the active transport act against the concentration gradient, means that gradient means the difference, concentration means the amount. Okay, so the difference in the amount, so how we can relate it? From lower concentration to higher concentration. Okay, so when there will be movement from lower to higher concentration, it will require energy, and whenever we are talking about energy, we are talking about the ATP, because ATP is the energy currency of the cell. So it will utilize this ATP molecule, as well as in some of the cases they require some sodium and potassium pump. Okay, so if we'll talk about this plasma membrane, what will happen? The active transport which is taking place, it is taking place from the lower concentration, and what it will require? It will require some of the sodium and potassium pump. Okay, and due to that, what will happen? There will be transportation of movement of molecules from lower to higher one. Right, another transport is passive transport. As I have said, if something is moving from higher concentration to lower concentration, it doesn't require any energy, no need of an ATP here, and we will call it that some simpler transportation takes place here. Okay, and accordingly we have classified this passive transport into three parts, that is osmosis, simple diffusion and facilitated diffusion. So all three comes under the passive transport. Why? Because all three method doesn't require any ATP. If it doesn't require any ATP, what will happen? There will be just movement. If I will talk about the definition of osmosis, osmosis is what? Osmosis is just movement of water molecule. Diffusion is also movement, but when we are talking about the osmosis, we are talking about the water molecules. Okay, when we are talking about the diffusion, we are talking about the gases. Okay, so for transportation or for the movement of water molecules from higher concentration to lower concentration through a semi-permeable membrane. So this plasma membrane will act as a semi-permeable membrane, and anything which is coming from higher concentration, it will get readily moved towards the lower concentration with the help of this passive transport. Okay, and we know that this one is the polar head. Okay, this one is the polar head. So what will happen? It will be easier for them to come through this plasma membrane very easily. Right, diffusion is what? If some gases are present, it should have to get inside. What will happen? Again, this plasma membrane will act upon it. Okay, it doesn't require any more complicated form. So what will happen? There will be a diffusion of gases from the higher concentration to the lower concentration very easily without any need of any ATP. Right, and what is this facilitated diffusion? Facilitated diffusion means that something we are if gases are not able to move through this plasma membrane, so this proteins are present, okay? So this facilitated proteins are there which help them to get inside it, right? So again, they don't require any ATP because passively they are moving from the higher concentration, right? So we can say that here, this is the structure, this is the functioning of the plasma membrane, how it will act upon it, and what are the different components present in the plasma membrane. And this plasma membrane is very, very important. Okay, so we will understand that what is the function of this plasma membrane. So here, the function of plasma membrane are, the first one is selectively permeable or semi-permeable. Okay, it will act as a permeable membrane. As I have said, that this membrane will function as a transportation or the entrance or exit of the materials or the molecules. So how it is acting as a semi or the selectively permeable. There is one difference between the selectively permeable and the semi permeable. Semi permeable means that if something is moving from outside to inside, what will happen? As I have said, that this is a plasma membrane, double lipid bilayer. What will happen? That in case of semi permeable, okay, in case of semi permeable, there may be some of the things like holes are present in this plasma membrane. So it will select that what should be enter inside the cell or what should not be. Okay, so that time it is a semi-permeable, and selectively permeable is what? In which, in the selectively permeable, we can say that, for example, as I have said, proteins are there. Okay, these proteins are protein, embedded protein is present. So the thing which is present in the plasma membrane will act as a barrier. It will only pass only those things which are important or which is needed. If water is needed inside it, so it will take water. Okay, if any other thing, if gas is required, if it will take gases. But if the thing which is present outside, if it is not required by the cell, so it will not get inside this plasma membrane, or we can say it will not allow any of the molecules to the inside if it is not needed. Right, so for that we are having different things like aquaporins, which will pass only water molecules. Right, so like this, there are different components present in the plasma membrane which will decide that what should be enter inside this cell and what should not be. Right, so it will act as a membrane, selectively permeable as well as the semi-permeable membrane. Second, the functioning of the semi-permeable membrane is that it will protect the cell from the injury. Okay, so whatever the components which is present inside the cell, so this membrane is giving protection to the cell. Okay, it is giving protection to the protoplasm, it is giving protection to the other internal parts of the plant cells. Right, so that's why it will act as a protection. Then the carrier protein for active transport. What is the meaning of active transport? Active transport in which the movement will be due to the utilization of ATP molecule. So in active transport, what is required? Some of the energy in form of ATP is needed, and for that we are having carrier protein. Okay, we are having different carrier protein in the plasma membrane which will move the things from lower concentration to higher concentration with the help of ATP. So what is happening, what, how they are moving? With the help of this carrier protein. Right, so these carrier proteins are present here in this plasma membrane. Okay, now along with this, they contain some enzymes also, ATPase enzyme for their metabolic activity. So we can say that it contains enzyme for having proper activity of the plant cells. Right here, so these are the function of the plasma membrane. Okay, now if we will move towards the another component and the part of the cell, that is the cell wall. Already we have covered about the cell membrane, this plasma membrane, and now we will discuss about the cell wall. Now when we are talking about the cell wall, so we are talking about the plant cells, right? Because this cell wall is absent where? In case of animal cells. So we can say that cell wall is present only in case of plant cells. Now it is discovered by the Robert Hooke in 1665. These questions are important for the MCQ, right? Now if we'll talk about the structure of the cell wall, how it is made up of, what is the composition of the cell wall. So we can say that it is a rigid one, okay, and this one is the non-living. It means that it's not a living one. So if I will draw the structure of cell wall here, okay, so this is the cell, okay, this is the cell, and we know that cell is a compartment like structure, okay. Now in this cell, what you will see that there will be some outer part. We have divided this cell wall again into different parts, okay. We will understand that how we can make a different component, what is the function of this cell wall. So here we can say that it is a rigid one, okay. And one more important point which we have discussed earlier, that in case of plant cells we are having vacuole, okay, and the nucleus is situated at the periphery. So what we can see that major part of this one, okay, major part of this one is what? It is the vacuole. What it is? It is the vacuole, and nucleus is somehow like this, right here. So 90% part is covered by the vacuole here. Now along with this, okay, we have said outer covering of plants, only these are present where in case of plants, and differentiate into three parts. Now it is important how I will make you understand here, that it consists of three parts. The outer part which I have drawn here, this one, it is known as what? It is known as the primary cell wall. What it is? Primary cell wall. So cell wall having three layers, this differentiated to three parts. The outer one is primary cell wall, and if you will move inner to that, what you will see that some of the part which I have drawn here with the help of this dotted one, okay, this dotted one, this whole structure is representing what? This is representing the middle lamella. Middle means in between two. So what you can say that this one is the middle lamellae, right? It one is the middle lamellae, and the third part is what? It is the secondary cell wall. So secondary, it means that this is inner to the primary cell wall. So you can see that this layer is represented by this red one, right? So this is what? This is the, we can say, secondary cell wall. What you will say? Secondary cell wall. And this secondary cell wall is thicker than what? It is thicker than the primary cell wall. So I am writing here, it is the secondary cell wall, right here. So we have said here, we have understand that cell wall, it is having differentiated into three layers: primary, secondary, and the middle lamella. One by one we will understand that what is the function of this three layers, right here. So this middle lamella, okay, this middle lamella which is present here, one more important thing, now I will draw it here, there will be some pore like structure, okay. You can see that there is some pore like structure, right. So what you will call it? It is known as plasmodesmatum. So now one by one we will understand it, what it is. So first one is the middle lamella. The middle lamella is present where? In the between, and it is made up of what? It is made up of pectin. Pectin is what? Jelly like, sticky like component, sticky like structure. So what it will do? It will stick the cells, okay. What it will do? It will stick the cells, and it will providing proper gluing of the cell in case of plant, right. That's why the major component present in the middle lamella is the pectin one, right. And now how this middle lamella is sticking to each other? It is sticking with the help, for example, if I will draw the structure of cell, okay, if I will draw the structure of cells, what you will see that there is a cementing like structure, okay, there will be cementing like structure which is connecting to each and every cell. So which is connecting here, it is known as plasmodesmata. So this plasmodesmata is connecting each and every cell, and it helps to pass the cytoplasm from one cell to another cell, one cell to another cell, right. So we can say that this type of cells are present all over it, right? And with the help of this plasmodesmal matter, they are connecting with each other. For example, this is one of the cell, this is one of the cell, and they both are connected with what? It is connected with the help of the plasmodesmal matter. Through this plasmodesmal matter, there will be exchange of cytoplasm, exchange of nutrients from one cell to another cell, right? So we have done about the middle lamella. Now comes to the primary cell wall. So this primary cell wall, this which one is the outer one, it is made up of cellulose. We know that the cell wall of plant having major component of cellulose, as well as it contains some of the part of hemicellulose as well as the pectin, right? Now if you will talk about the secondary cell wall, as I have said, is inner to it, and it is made up of lignin. Everything is present here in the inner cell wall as well: cellulose, hemicellulose, pectin. But along with this, there will be one more component, that is lignin, is present in case of secondary cell wall. And this primary cell wall, you can see where in the growing tissues, okay, where the growth has been taking place, this primary cell wall is present. And what about the secondary cell wall? This secondary cell wall is present mostly in case of the woody plants, okay, in which there will be growth, or after the maturation it will form the secondary cell wall, right? So we have done all three parts. Now comes to the function, whether it is the outer or the middle or the secondary one, what all of them is providing? They are providing the protection to the cell, okay? So major function of this cell wall, it is providing protection from the mechanical injury. If an injury will be there, it will be healed up by this cell wall, as well as it will provide protection from the pathogen also, because if there will be any injury, so there will be a chances of attack of pathogen. So what they are doing, they are making the cell wall properly so that pathogen will not get inside the cell, right? Here, so it is giving protection from the mechanical injury, as well as it is providing barrier for the pathogen so that pathogen will not get enter inside the cell, right? Here, then another one is a definite shape. So the shape is provide the shape of the plant cell also given by the cell wall, because in our body we are having skeleton. So here they are having this cell wall, which is providing rigidity to the cell, okay? And how? Because we know that there will be more part of what? Vacuole, water will be more, so it may be chances of getting bursting. So what it is required? It is required that there will be proper cell wall which will neutralize this effect here. Clear? So we can say it is providing definite shape to the cell. Now second part, we already have discussed, providing protection to the cell, as well as cell to cell interaction. So what is the function of this cell wall? It is providing cell to cell. It means that it is providing transport of water and minerals, or whatever the nutrients is required, it can be transported through this cell wall, right? Here, so we are having these function of the cell wall, right? So one more important thing which I have to discuss here, we said that cell wall is present only in case of plant cells. What are the other example in which this cell wall is present? But the difference is that the cell wall of plant is made up of cellulose, some hemicellulose and pectin is there, but this cell wall is present in case of bacteria as well as fungi also, okay? In case of bacteria, it is made up of what? It is made up of murine, which is a type of peptidoglycan, and in case of fungi, it is made up of chitin. Very very important, the cell wall of fungi is made up of what? Chitin, and chitin is a type of polysaccharide, okay? It is a type of polysaccharide. One exception is there in case of bacteria, as mycoplasma comes under this one, what will happen? That there will be no cell wall in case of mycoplasma, right? Otherwise, in bacteria, there is cell wall which is made up of the murine, okay? So today we have completed the cell membrane and the cell wall. In the later session, we will study more about the components of eukaryotic cells, right? So that's all for today. Thank you.